I mean, I first heard about it on the news like most people.
They're saying it's just like the flu. I've gotten the flu before. I'm young, I'm healthy, therefore I should be fine.
You know, I was kind of playing chicken with the virus, I felt, and still going out.
I was doing DoorDash. I was going from restaurant to restaurant.
I had two birthday parties, one on a Friday and one on a Saturday. I manifested symptoms 48 hours after that, after the birthday parties.
The shooting pain up my back, the coughing was so bad that I needed to go to the hospital.
I was asleep, and then I could feel myself not breathing. I knew I was not breathing.
I could feel my heart just racing.
A little emotional about it, but because it was the first time that, like, I've ever wondered if I was gonna live.
The whole thing with COVID is the after effects are just as, it's almost just as bad as the sickness.
Each and every time I got out of the shower, more clumps kept falling out of my hair.
And it started to fall out in massive chunks.
I bled like no other. It was almost like I was hemorrhaging for 8 days straight. My blood work was that of like an 80-year-old woman that's been on, had menopause.
I think I had 3 UTIs in like a month and a half or something, or maybe 2 months.
I don't have any cavities. I have always had amazing good teeth. And then she's like, your gums have deteriorated.
I have sexual issues. It's hard to talk about.
You are just kind of on your own, in your own world, being gaslit by society of like, it's fake, this is fake, it's the government, na 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 na, and you're like.
People aren't making these symptoms up.
Hello, my name is Zephyrin Anderson. I'm born for the Mudhouse people.
Well, my name is Marvin Belisle. I'm from New Orleans, Louisiana.
My name is Emily Esposito. I'm 27 and I live in Mobile, Alabama.
I'm originally from Long Island, New York. But I currently live in Atlanta, Georgia.
And I'm a COVID survivor.
Why COVID-19 survivors?
The idea for the COVID survivors, it actually started in 2014 when I was documenting the stories of Ebola survivors.
When COVID started spreading in New York, it felt like deja vu to 6 years earlier at the beginning of 2014 in my apartment in Monrovia, Liberia.
In Liberia, during Ebola, there wasn't a lot of healthcare. And so oftentimes people went to this Ebola treatment unit and it was more like an isolation center where they were looked at by healthcare workers, but they weren't able to give them a lot of treatments for multiple reasons. One being there just weren't treatments. There was no treatment for Ebola. And so the people that survived, it wasn't necessarily because they had better healthcare. There's almost like something special, something unique about these people that made them survive. And I wanted to know why. William was one of the first survivors that we documented.
Our friend, because when that signal is in you, you can be our friend. The virus started from my uncle in July. And suddenly, my wife, she called me and said, oh, William, but I'm not feeling fine. So while we were here, there was no place to take her. So later, I went to African Sound Man, here for her to survive. But there was no means. She died in my hand. I started crying. Then myself, my head was just hurting, winning. When I came locally, my nephew called me. He said, try and go to EOW, let me check you. The treatment was very fun. They were treating me, tablet, food, and all that things. But for my survival, I started praying.
I was there at the MSF Ebola treatment unit the day that he was released, and he walked out with his son, who was, I think he was about 4 or 5 at the time, a really little guy. And we were all in tears because it was the first time that Ebola treatment unit had released people, because they'd only opened about 2 to 3 weeks earlier. And everyone else that left in body bags. They didn't walk out. So it was the first time that these doctors actually got to see people come out alive.
I didn't think that what happened in West Africa would ever happen in the United States.
To date, we have confirmed 6 cases of this novel virus in the United States.
The degree of risk has the potential to change quickly, especially if we see sustained spread of the disease around the world, which could qualify this disease as a pandemic.
When COVID-19 started spreading where we lived in 2020, my husband Jacob and I began documenting stories of COVID-19 survivors. Jen was one of the first people we met. She's a nurse at a hospital in Manhattan. When she was a teenager, she was diagnosed with psoriatic arthritis, fibromyalgia, and hypothyroidism. Thanks to her compromised immune system, she was in the first wave of people to catch COVID.
My body doesn't respond to bacteria and viruses in the way a healthy person's immune system responds. You're supposed to fight it. I kind of invited over for lunch and help it hurt me. So it's a unique position to be in when I get sick, because I have to be very careful. We definitely heard about COVID-19 through the news. The word on the low was kind of like the media was hyping it up and people were kind of blowing this out of proportion. And we thought that it was only gonna affect the elderly. So I definitely was not scared at first. All of a sudden, you went from March 6th, I only knew about a couple cases, and no lockdowns, no stay-at-homes, to the 14th. Hearing that flights are being canceled, people can't get home, they're shutting down the city starting Monday.
To unleash the full power of the federal government in this effort today, I am officially declaring a national emergency.
We will see more cases and we will see more suffering and death, predominantly among the vulnerables in our society.
And that's when it set in that I'm a high-risk immunosuppressed patient, and me going into this is putting my life at risk.
Before catching COVID, Maya was an author and a speaker.
Hey everyone, my name is Maya McNulty. My friends call me the fundraising maverick because I maximize fundraising by thinking like an entrepreneur. Thanks for joining me. I want to invite you to a very special...
After being put on a ventilator and trached to save her life, her vocal cords were damaged. So when we met her, she was still learning how to speak again.
I was one of the first young females in all upstate New York to get COVID at such a severe level. I've never had any pre-existing conditions. I was healthy. Saturday the 14th, I got up and I said, I strangely do not feel well. And for me to take myself to the emergency room, something has got to be seriously wrong with me. I asked for a test for the coronavirus. And it was though I was asking for gold, Monday morning at 7 o'clock, the Department of Health calls, my doctor's office calls, and the emergency room calls and says that you tested positive for the coronavirus, but I started to lose my taste of smell, my appetite, and I started with a fever. And come Wednesday that week, I was starting to die of respiratory failure from my feet up, but I didn't know it.
On Monday, I noticed like a decrease in my taste and my smell. And what kind of made me feel weird though was I had ordered spicy chicken wings and I couldn't taste them. But I still didn't think I had COVID because that wasn't a symptom that was talked about at that time. Tuesday, I woke up with what felt like a cold, and throughout the day progressed to I felt like I had the flu. Friday came, my symptoms went from feeling like I had the flu to feeling like I had labored breathing, extreme fatigue and weakness. My wet cough turned into dry. It was so bone dry that it hurt. By Sunday, I had to take like deep breaths after 2 to 3 words. I could barely walk to my kitchen, and I live in a studio. I could barely walk to the bathroom without having to stop and gasp for air. By 9 o'clock, I was sitting on my couch, very calm, kind of getting into like a meditated headspace, and I just felt like I had a horse galloping like on my chest. So like I was having palpitations. I also had severe chest pain, and then I started gasping for air. I was unsure if one of those gasps would have been my last one. I was afraid to call 911 and it'd take too long. I put on a mask. I wrapped a scarf around my face. I called an Uber. I'm only 4 blocks from the hospital. And I said, open the windows and drive fast and bring me to the emergency room.
Thursday, I completely stopped eating. On Friday, I couldn't walk anymore. I'm starting to turn blue. My husband says, I'm either carrying you down these steps or I'm going to call an ambulance. But he knew I was dying because of the look of the color of my skin. When we got to the hospital, my oxygen must have been in the 60s, dropped 20 from the week before. All I can remember is getting wheeled in there and then counting down 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. My family was terrified. My mom, my dad, everyone was terrified. My husband was told to bring our daughter home from college to say goodbye to her mom. But I didn't know what I was going through. I was in a coma. I slept through it all.
Every day there seems to be a record of number of deaths compared to the day before. In fact, New York today had again another record of, I think the city itself was about 820 plus deaths.
In the United States, in an ICU, nurses usually take care of between 1 to 2 patients. And now I was taking care of like 5 or 6 by myself, and they were the sickest patients that I ever saw. When my patient died, I couldn't step away because I had 5 others that were just as sick and on the verge of dying. Jen and I started working together at the same place on the same exact day, and we instantly became friends.
Are we gonna show everyone how cute you are?
Oh my goodness. Jen was admitted into the same hospital that I was working in as a COVID ICU nurse. When she was in the emergency room, she put me on speakerphone just so I could listen to everything the doctors were saying because she was so overwhelmed. And all I could picture in my mind was her getting so sick like all these other patients.
I'm back on oxygen because I had an episode. I dropped to 95 while my nurse was in the room.
And the room I was in and the unit I was on is identical to the 4th floor where I worked. Every patient that I had ever taken care of in that room, like their face just flashed before my eyes, and the walls just started to get smaller and I felt very suffocated. Then I also had to deal with knowing that my family couldn't get to me. And if I was, God, I knew this was gonna happen. It's one thing to be in the hospital and be scared, but it's another thing to not have a family member by your side.
I want to go home, I want my bed.
I was afraid what would happen if it came to me being put on a vent. And I said, give me 24 hours, I will get off this oxygen, and I did. My mom and I hadn't FaceTimed until Tuesday. And we just looked at each other in silence and just cried.
So, I feel pretty good today. Just saw my doctors, and I'm going home.
And I woke up 35 days later, and I had a stay of 69 days in the hospital. And I almost died of COVID 3 times in respiratory failure because my lungs had collapsed. I was in so much pain. My body felt like shards of glass, like fiberglass. I didn't have movement in my legs, in my feet, in my arms. I was tube fed, and I have a big hole here now and a big scar down my stomach.
And then it hit me again on the 9th of April. But I basically fainted in my apartment. I was no longer at the point where I could care for myself or, you know that it was time to call 911. It would have happened too quick. So I came home. My mom has hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. So she gets shortness of breath. She has really high blood pressure. You know, coming here was a risk because with my mom's heart disease, she is somebody that would die. She would not stand a chance. That was the risk of me coming home. You know, it's a really nerve-wracking time. You know, I was discharged from the hospital on the 25th, and little did we know, one of my mother's brothers was in the hospital, and he tested negative for COVID, but he had congestive heart failure. I almost feel like one life was taken to spare mine. He died at 3:10 p.m. and my birthday is March 10th. And then another one of my mom's brothers died yesterday around 3 p.m. He tested positive. So it's been a lot for us as a family to process. When you think about how do you live your life after this, after so much grief and tragedy, and I'm almost mourning the loss of the person I was before March 2020. It's almost like I've gone through a rebirth again. You know, not only is that my perspective has changed on life and things that are important, but the way I see my future and how I see myself has completely changed. It made me realize how important it is for me to have public outreach. I have this like burning passion now to do something about healthcare. I know that on a larger scale, I can impact a lot of people. I faced my fears. I've been forced to face like my inner demons, let's say, of my health issues, and always thinking like it stood in my way of things. And now I'm realizing that I never thought I would be grateful for every single health problem I've ever had, because I wouldn't be this person today and I wouldn't be on this journey if I didn't get sick with COVID, and I wouldn't change a single thing no matter how difficult it's been. I'm alive and I kiss the ground literally every morning that I wake up.
Originally, my doctor said that my recovery would take about a year because they don't know anything about this virus and they're learning every day. Sometimes just walking or talking, my heart just elevates and the tremors, the vibrations in my body just start. Left leg. I'm never going to be the normal way I used to be, so I'm embracing who I've become. I'm walking with a cane now. I'm working with a therapist, a linguistic therapist, to help me to speak again. So I had to learn how to swallow all over again and eat because I was being tube-fed for over 55 days. I started to lose my memory. I suffer from brain fog. I lost my hair, but...
Yeah. This is all new, rejuvenated hair.
It's so exciting.
And the last how many months I've seen you, since the first time, you have grown almost, you know, 4, almost 5 inches of regrowth.
You know, it's okay, because it's a transition, and I lost my voice, and as a speaker, it's difficult to speak. I get injections every 4 weeks in my keloid scar because it got infected from the ventilator. I don't like how it looks. It's embarrassing to me, but, you know, it's okay because it's a badge of honor. You know, when my oxygen level went to 60, that's brain damage. But by the grace of God, somehow, I'm not brain damaged. So I think of something positive because there are people that have it worse than me. When I was in a coma, there were thousands of people lifting me up, and I have to return that favor somehow. And I feel indebted and I feel grateful for it. Healthcare workers were heroes.
Why do you think it's important that people are sharing their experiences with COVID now?
Well, right now, we need advocacy, we need better policy, and honestly, we need people to believe that this is a serious illness. So in the immediate future, we need people to understand that this is real, that it affects people, that people die from it, that people are very, very ill. We need that, we need to sort of make this real for people. And that's why narratives are so wonderful. You can read as many news stories as you want, but when you hear someone talk about it, when you see that person and they become real, you can sort of understand, and that really does help people understand what is happening. But we also need this for the future, because if we forget this, we're in for a lot of problems in the future. Our policies right now with COVID and our state of public health in the United States is miserable. We are not handling this well, and we can compare ourselves to other nations. We are doing a terrible job, and we can try to turn this around and do better for COVID, but what's really important is that we develop better public policy for future epidemics and pandemics, because this will happen again. It might not be COVID, but it will be something else, and we need to be able to have funds. We need to be able to have plans, and so the more that we record our stories, it's helpful now, but it's helpful for the future, so we can figure out what we need to do and we can take this seriously as a society.
After sharing stories of dozens of COVID-19 survivors across the East Coast, we decided that wasn't enough. We wanted to document how COVID-19 is impacting people across America. So we moved out of our New York apartment and hit the road so we could document stories of COVID-19 survivors in all 50 states in America.
It's our moving day and our last day in the apartment. We're about to hit the road tomorrow. Sad about this apartment. Don't really want to leave it, but going on a big journey.
The next day, we moved into a 19-foot trailer that would be our home for the next 14 months.
Here we go. Journey has officially started.
418 days, 40,000 miles, 4 flights, and over 70 campsites later, we have now interviewed over 180 survivors in 50 states. It has not been easy. In fact, it's been one of the hardest seasons of our lives.
Thank you.
we allowed to in?
Yeah.
Okay, basically the whole inverter box here is lying loose.
We're stuck.
We are stuck.
How do you know we're stuck? We haven't...
We are stuck. We are digging ourselves in.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
That is the worst feeling.
Turning this into an action film.
But we'll never forget it, especially the incredible people we met along the way. In the films that follow, you'll get to know some of them and their stories. And you'll hear from experts who answer our questions about this virus as we drive through the heart of the outbreak across America.
This is our shadow pandemic.
I was a healthy 27-year-old who had no underlying conditions and was running every day to nothing.
I'm 33, and now I feel like I have the lungs of a 75-year-old.
Because I'm the youngest person here. My roommate before this was like 90. My roommate now is 88 years old.
At this point, I am, God, was it at 7, 8 months? Into this?
Like, if you ask me to do a burpee right now, I will faint. Straight up, I will faint. And it's been 148 days, I will absolutely faint.
At this time, I've already had it for like 6 weeks. And they tell me I need to try to walk, and I'm thinking like, of course I can walk, I've been walking. But for some reason, I couldn't walk.
Do we have any idea of the numbers of people who are getting long COVID at this point?
You're looking at 50 million people, and that was before Omicron.
If you've liked this video, please like, share, comment, and subscribe. This helps the YouTube algorithm share this video with others.
Right now, we're planning to release one episode a week for the next 12 weeks, but we have a lot more content than that. And if we can get additional funding, then we can keep going and share more stories.
Please consider becoming a Patreon member, as this helps us share these stories with others. You can follow the link below.
Also, over the next couple days, we'll release extended interviews with some of the people in this episode. You can find them on our YouTube channel, in addition to the webpage dedicated to this episode, which will also have extra resources about the topic that we covered.
Thank you again for watching, and please tune in next Thursday for the next episode.